Selamat datang ke rancangan Bicara.
Apa yang memberikan anda lesen ya untuk bercakap tentang Islam, tentang dialog antara agama?
When Allah spoke, it spoke on minor matters, but matters of real significance to Muslims, it kept silent about. I knew everything about Islam. I knew that Muslims blow themselves up and that they chop your hands off. He says, I'm a Muslim fundamentalist with the emphasis on fun. You know, Islam is full of fun.
Selamat datang ke rancangan Bicara.
Seorang penceramah Islam antarabangsa berasal dari Britain yang semakin mendapat perhatian di lingkaran antarabangsa menjadi tamu bicara. Idris Tawfiq, seorang pendakwah Islam yang unik kerana beliau pernah menjadi patri Roman Katolik yang mendapat pendidikan agama di Vatican di Rome yang merupakan pusat Katolik sejagat. Disebabkan latar belakang beliau yang luar biasa itu, Encik Idris Tawfiq kini giat mempromosikan dialog antara agama dan berjuang menunjukkan imej sebenar Islam kepada masyarakat antarabangsa dengan kaedah penuh diplomasi. Matlamat beliau mengubah tanggapan dan gambar negatif orang bukan Islam tentang agama Islam, khususnya di kalangan bukan Muslim di negara barat. Dan misinya itu membawa beliau berucap di sekitar 50 universiti serata dunia sejauh ini. Idris Tawfiq kini bertugas sebagai pensyarah di Fakulti Bahasa dan Penterjemahan di Universiti Al-Azhar di Mesir. Dan sebelum itu, menjadi ketua jabatan pengajian agama di beberapa sekolah di England dan Wales. Walaupun baru 11 tahun memeluk Islam, beliau sudah menulis 9 buah buku untuk mempromosi keindahan Islam. Sekitar 2 minggu lalu, beliau berada di Singapura untuk mengadakan beberapa ceramah awam dan bicara berpeluang bertemu beliau untuk mencungkil dan menyelami pengalaman serta perspektif beliau tentang penyampaian Islam kontemporari.
Encik Idris Tawfiq, selamat datang ke rancangan Bicara.
Selamat pagi. Thank you very much.
Baik, ingin saya mulakan soalan saya begini ya. Anda menyatakan dalam blog anda bahawa anda bukan seorang sarjana Islam. Jadi apa yang memberikan anda lesen ya untuk bercakap tentang Islam, tentang dialog antara agama?
Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. That's a very, very good question. You know, when I'm speaking to audiences, I say to all of my audiences all the time, my dear brothers and sisters, you know more about Islam than I do. You know, one of our problems in the world today with Muslims is that many people speak with an authority that they don't have about Islam. Especially if I can give you a result of the revolution in Egypt. You know, for many years, Al-Azhar, which for 1,000 years has been the authoritative voice of Sunni Islam in the world, for 1,000 years, in recent years, Al-Azhar has been tied closely to a regime that has been less than good. You know, I'm not speaking behind anyone's back. People will say this in Egypt. And so the consequence has been that Al-Azhar has lost the respect of ordinary Muslims of the street. And when Al-Azhar spoke, it spoke on minor matters, but matters of real significance to Muslims, it kept silent about.
Contohnya bagaimana?
Well, for example, it would give fatwas on whether a woman can wear a trouser suit, because the president's wife wore trouser suits. But on things to do with Palestine or Iraq or Afghanistan, we didn't really hear anything. So Muslims want to hear from their religious leaders, and they weren't hearing anything. So voices began to emerge from mountain caves and desert camps, speaking on behalf of Islam and speaking with an authority they didn't have. Now, everyone's entitled to their opinion. We can all have our opinions, but we don't represent Islam. And the problem with this was, not only was it confusing Muslims, they were hearing voices that were creating tensions between Islam and the West that have never existed. But as well, the Western world was hearing a distorted view of Islam. It wasn't hearing the real Islam. So inshallah, one of the beautiful things to me as a result of the revolution in Egypt is that Al-Azhar has been set free from the shackles it was bound by in the past. And already we see it rising once more to its former role of the leader, the authentic voice in the world. So inshallah, in the future, we won't have these voices that claim to speak on behalf of Islam. I make no such claim. I'm a very simple man. I say to my audiences, as I say, you know more about Islam than I do. I'm a baby in Islam. I've been Muslim for 11 years.
Baik, jadi sebenarnya apa ya misi anda, apa motivasi anda ya dalam bercakap tentang Islam?
Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. I say that my work is twofold. I work to encourage Muslims to be good Muslims. And I work to encourage tolerance and respect and friendship between Muslims and those who are not. One group I like to speak to, though, especially, are those Muslims who've perhaps fallen away. You know, I do a lot of work with young people, with university students, young professionals, and many of them, you know, in Egypt we do this. It means we've had enough. And many young Muslims, they say, we've had enough of this. We've heard it all before. We've heard it in the mosque. We don't want to hear any more. We want no more religion. But they are Muslims. They have Islam in their hearts. And you know, we spend, as Muslims, we spend a fortune on dawah. We write books and we make videos and television programs and all sorts of posters to get new people to become Muslim. Well, you know, we have millions of Muslims who know nothing of Islam. They know nothing of Allah. And we have a duty to them because they really are our brothers and sisters. It's not just a nice name. They are our brothers and sisters. And so I love it. You know, it's lovely when someone emails me and says, I declared Shahada after your talk. Or after a talk, they actually come and declare Shahada. That's lovely. But it really is touching when someone emails me and says, Brother Idris, you know, I haven't prayed for the last 6 years. And as a result of your talk or a program I saw or something you wrote, I have started praying again. That really is very touching.
Jadi anda menyatakannya bahwa ini soal berhubung dengan cara yang baru ya, yang lebih kontemporari, dan ini yang nampaknya begitu berkurangan dalam penyebaran atau dalam penyampaian Islam sejauh ini.
Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Islam is very simple. It is so simple. But as grown-ups, as Muslims, we've made it so very complicated. You know, Islam is the natural religion of mankind. It's existed since the beginning of time, and it's meant for all people, Muslim and non-Muslim. And its message is very simple. The message of Islam is that there is a God. So the message of Islam, you take, for example, Haiti, that terrible earthquake in Haiti. Imagine a man in Haiti, he's never prayed in his life. He's not Muslim, he never prayed. And he's digging with his bare hands in the rubble, looking for his son. It is natural for him to cry out with tears running down his face, God, save my boy. Take my eyes, but save my boy. And Islam speaks to him. There is a God, and there's a God who cares. A man in Japan standing in his village, and he sees coming towards him a wall of water 30 feet high. He naturally cries out, naturally, save us. Save. So the message of Islam really does speak to the hearts of all. All people have it within themselves. We're all born with an inclination towards our Creator, towards Allah. And young people are no different. And Muslim young people, you know, they have within themselves, all young people, they've a yearning. Now many people, they fill that yearning with drink, or with drugs, or with whatever, you name it, you know. But they're not looking for drink or really they're looking for Allah.
Baik, anda sebenarnya mempunyai kemahiran istimewa ya, yaitu kemahiran berhubungan ya dengan golongan bukan Muslim dan juga dengan golongan Muslim ya, sehingga mereka menerima anda ya. Kalau boleh anda kongsi dengan kami, sebenarnya apa prinsip utama atau rahsia ya, teknik berhubungan yang anda amalkan itu?
If you're going to talk to people about faith, you must speak to them in a language that they can understand. You know, another example, the mosque where I pray. There are lots of poor people come to the mosque on a Friday for Friday prayers. Friday isn't a holiday if you're poor, you have to work. So lots of young mechanics come in and they're hot and tired from their labor, and they sit there and they've come to the mosque to hear from their religious leader how to find a pious wife. You know, how to deal with employers that treat them unjustly, how to deal with corrupt officials. And all they hear is how to go to the toilet properly, how long your galabeya should be, how to curl your toes properly in the mosque. These are important things. I'm not dismissing them. They're important, but they're not that important. And you know, we should be feeding people's hearts. These young men have come to the mosque. Alhamdulillah, they're there. Unless we cater for them, they won't be there in the future. You know, so we need to speak to people where they are, not where we would want them to be. You know, if all people are interested in is football, well, we talk to them about football. And we catch their interest, and then we can take them from football to Islam. But we don't start with Sharia law. We've got a lifetime to talk about Sharia law. Talk about what interests them. You know, use your natural gifts of being able to attract people. Let them be attracted to you. There's a saint in the Christian church who long ago used to say, you'll attract more bees with a spoonful of honey than with a barrel full of vinegar. And it's very true. The bees will come to the honey. They won't come to a great big vat of vinegar. So as Muslims, as speakers, you know, as religious leaders, we need to speak to people in a way they'll understand us, not in a way that will confuse them.
Kita gerek tu macam jiwa dia memang untuk seni.
Makanan gini, kita monyet.
Kalau tak menjadi penyanyi, Jamal Abdillah jadi apa? Banyak aku miliki.
Hai, saya Jamal Abdillah. Jangan lupa saksikan Kita Gerek.
Selasa 8:30 malam di Suria.
Rintihan dan keluhan.
Papa dengan Mama ni sama je tau. Suka memalukan Rina aja. Bosan Rina lelak dengan sikap kohon orang ni.
Mendabur fitnah atas kepentingan diri sendiri.
Sebelum berlakunya apa-apa, lebih baik kita ni jauhkan diri pada dia.
Pertolongan yang dihulurkan membawa pada tragedi. Saksikan Janji Kekasih Selasa 9:30 malam di Suria.
When you're asking investors for cash,
start the music, start the show. Now we can see that she's dancing more energetically, more intensively.
Is that legal?
Don't expect an easy ride.
If you lose a product, can you give money back to us?
The trick is to stay calm. See how it's done on Angel's Gate, Monday at 8 p.m.
Si Dara mencari sesuatu yang belum pasti ditemui.
Cepatnya kau dapat lupakan kisah lampau, eh.
Kau apa ni ingat lagi dah?
Kau minat ke dengan bodybuilder tu?
Aku terima nikahnya. Selasa, 10:30 malam, hanya di Suria.
Apa agaknya yang dalam pandangan anda hilang ya dalam perbendaharaan kata orang Islam secara umum ya, apabila mereka bercakap kepada orang bukan Islam, bercakap tentang agama mereka sebenarnya ya?
Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. That's a very important question too. And I think a word that is missing is humility. We need a humility in speaking to people, not an arrogance. And our humility and our gentleness will convey itself. You know, I say a lot, you can speak about Islam to people without ever mentioning Islam. We don't need to lecture. People don't want to be lectured to. People don't want to be told you are wrong. You know, if you tell someone they're wrong, they'll immediately put up barriers to you. I'll give you an example. I give a talk called Jesus, Son of God, ? And this talk's very popular with Christian and Muslim audiences. Now, I don't say to the audiences, you're all wrong in believing that Jesus is the Son of God. That would be very arrogant of me to say. And the audience wouldn't listen to me. They'd immediately be defensive. What I do is I say, I used to believe this, and now I believe this, and I want to explain to you how I got from there to there. And the audience, it doesn't threaten them. They're hearing it at a third remove, and they say, okay, we'll listen to what he has to say. Yeah, that's quite reasonable. You know, so I think humility is one word. Gentleness is another. We need to be very gentle and calm and quiet. We don't need to shout. A lot of our religious speakers shout very loudly, you know, wah, wah, hak, wah, wah. Allah Almighty isn't deaf. And nor are people, especially with modern technology, with microphones. We can speak very calmly. And the way we speak in itself can convey a message. Islam isn't a threat. People in the West, you know, they have this misconception through TV and media that Islam is somehow a threat. Islam isn't a threat to anyone. And sometimes the way we're talking doesn't equal what we're saying. Another example. When some years ago we had those awful cartoons, our beloved Prophet, salatu wassalam, in Denmark, showing the Prophet, peace be upon him, with a hand grenade here. I remember I was in Cairo, and I remember on the news that night, the first item on the news, the Grand Imam of Al-Azhar, the Grand Sheikh Al-Azhar, condemned these cartoons. And he said, Islam is not how they are portraying it. Islam is not a religion of violence. It's not aggressive. It's not uncompromising. It is the world's message of peace. That was item number one. Item number two on the news showed a Muslim mob throwing stones and chanting and shouting and down with this country and down with that one. And I said to myself, look what we're doing. We're saying one thing and we're doing something else. And the people in the West are saying, well, look, we said they were like that. You know, we can condemn, but we don't need to condemn by shouting. So this is how we can dispel misconceptions by the way we behave and by the way we speak, by our manners.
Mungkin masalah yang lebih besar ialah kegagalan umat Islam ya untuk menggunakan media bagi menunjukkan imej Islam yang lebih murni, lebih baik lagi berbanding gambaran negatif tentang Islam yang sudah pun dipaparkan. Jadi apa komen anda ya?
Bismillah, I think you're right. You know, in the Muslim world, we have more money than you could possibly imagine. With mountains of gold, you know, hordes of diamonds. There is money. Sometimes we don't even know what to do with the money that we've got that much. There are other religious communities. Take the Jews, for example. The Jews have been very clever in their history. And in one sense, we really must admire them. For their numbers, they've managed very well to get their message across. And they do it not just with clever use of media. They do it in many different ways. As Muslims, you know, we often don't miss an opportunity to miss an opportunity. You know, we seem to miss it half the time. We've got all the resources we need, but we don't use them well enough. One of our problems is we have these so-called Islamic channels on TV. And who's going to watch them? Only Muslims will watch them. No non-Muslims will watch them. And when you turn them on often, you know, I smile sometimes because you turn these programs on and there isn't a smile to be seen. Everyone is looking very severe. And talking about, let's be honest, talking about very trivial things often. Now, who's going to watch that? Maybe a Muslim might watch it and ring in and ask, shall I divorce my wife? They're those kind of programs. But the people who need to know about Islam, including Muslims, they're not being served well. The majority of people in the West, they know nothing about Islam at all. Nothing. They don't hate Islam, they just don't know anything. The only information they get about Islam comes from the TV. And often, you know, the TV wants to present sensational stories. If you have 100 cars going past your building in a day, and two of the cars have an accident, in the newspaper they'll show the two cars. But they won't show the 98 that didn't have an accident, that just drove very calmly. Well, it's the same with life with Muslims. You know, if a bomb goes off somewhere, that's sensational and exciting for the news. But it isn't very exciting to show the majority of Muslims teaching their kids how to recite Quran. It isn't news. So we need to put things in perspective as Muslims about what the media is doing. If it bleeds, it leads, you know? The media are looking for exciting stories. But we need to put things in perspective and also get involved in media outlets and speak in a calm and gentle way about the real message of Islam. You know, I teach at Al-Azhar. I'm with students all the time. I travel around the world and I'm speaking to Muslim young people, students, young professionals. So I hear their concerns. I know what they're thinking. Well, if you're 18 and you're 19, you don't really want to hear that all the things that are fun are denied you, you know? Islam is perfect. And there are reasons for everything in Islam. Allah Almighty made us, and He knows what's best for us. And so if there's a prohibition on drinking alcohol, He knows more than we do. But we have a duty to explain to our young people, we don't drink, this is why we don't drink. It won't help, it will harm you. I have a friend, a young man in the UK, and on Facebook he describes his religious political views. He says, I'm a Muslim fundamentalist, with the emphasis on fun. You know, Islam is full of fun. It really is fun. We're not told. We don't talk about our beloved Prophet, alayhi salatu wasalam, running down the street, throwing buckets of water at Aisha, may Allah be pleased with her, and she throwing buckets of water back. You know, we don't tell the world that our Prophet, alayhi salatu wasalam, told jokes to his wives every night. Jokes. You know, jokes, some people, they don't like the idea of jokes at all. We've just got into the mindset where Islam, for many of us, it's a burden on our shoulders. Islam is not a burden to anyone. Islam, the rules of Islam, the prohibitions in Islam are to make us better people. They're to make us the best we can possibly be.
Mari bersama Yoyo dan Yaya serta rakan-rakan berhibur sambil belajar.
Siapa yang dapat melengkapkan kerjaan dengan betul akan mendapat markah.
Mula! Mak Yaya!
Ahad 10 pagi hanya di Suria.
Minggu ini dalam Geng Anam, kemanakah Anam dan keluarganya pergi? Oh, Mandy pun ada. Mereka mengenali tentang seorang wanita yang terkenal dengan bunganya.
Awak tu yang cak si Nono masuk bercanding dengan bunga cahaya ayam yang busuk tu.
Aduh, sakit.
Sudah jadi ni.
Kalau nak tahu, jangan lupa tontoni Geng Anam.
Ahad 10.30 pagi di Suria.
Setiap minggu, 5 pemenang bertuah boleh memenangi Kalkitos eksklusif Geng Anam.
Lunsuri laman sinmsn.com/suria untuk menjawab kuis mingguan anda.
You're a soldier, choosing your battle. Pick yourself up and dust yourself off and back in the saddle.
Every day I'm shuffling.
I just can't stop loving you.
Migrations tomorrow 9 p.m. on Octo's Animal Night Friday.
Encik Idris Tawfiq, anda sebenarnya pernah tinggal di Vatican selama 5 tahun, ya. Aspek mana daripada pengalaman tersebut, ya, yang telah memperkaya diri anda sebagai seorang Muslim sekarang ini?
Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Living in Rome was a wonderful experience. Living in Rome taught me many, many things. It taught me to like beautiful things. Rome is very beautiful. I met good people, honest people, trying their best to serve Almighty God as best they can. And, you know, some people say to me, Brother Idris, what a change in your life. You were traveling along like this, and then you turned and went in a completely different direction. I don't see it like that. I see it as a straight line, going from here to where we are today. And it seems to me, you know, when I was sitting in those lecture halls in Rome, learning about church history and Old Testament Greek and all the Gospels and all of these things, I wasn't studying to be a priest. I can see that now. I was studying to be talking to you today. What I bring to Islam that's different, because I am, my background makes me different in the way I talk. It just brings me from a different perspective. And it teaches me to ask questions from the background I once had. It certainly makes me very understanding of non-Muslims. Very understanding. And you know, when as Muslims we say something, I think to myself, but non-Muslims won't like that answer because it will upset them. So we need to speak to them in a way that won't upset them. We need to speak to them. You know, often here in Singapore, one of the first things I did was I went and had dinner with Bishop Renis Ponia, the Anglican Bishop of Singapore. And wherever I go in the world, I try to extend a hand of friendship from Muslims to religious leaders of other faiths. And we had a lovely dinner, but we also spoke very profoundly as men of faith. And at the end of our discussion, having become friends in the discussion, we could then speak honestly and say to one another, you know, I believe that what you believe is wrong. And he could say, and I believe that what you believe is wrong, but let's remain friends. Let's talk again. In Islam, we have respect for the people of the book. We listen. We believe that their message is imperfect and that Islam is the fullness of revelation. But I think, in answer to your question, you know, Rome taught me to understand other people more. And maybe, of all things, that's the thing I bring to Islam. At the moment, for example, I'm working very much with religious leaders throughout the world on the whole issue of Christians in the Middle East. Because as a result of the Arab Spring, Christians in the Middle East are very fearful for their future. You know, they don't know what the future will hold, and the media are winding them up by telling them about the rise of Islamism. And they're fearful about what's going to happen and will they be able to worship. And many of them are leaving and going to other countries. And I wrote an article and I gave a talk recently called Cherishing the Christian Presence, saying how as Muslims we are actually the guardians of the Christian presence in the Middle East. Just in terms of justice, as Muslims we are called to defend those who are being treated unjustly. But as people of faith, we're also called, as our prophet did, to defend the rights of others to worship according to their own traditions.
Kongsi dengan kami, ya, apa dia cabaran-cabaran utama bagi orang-orang seperti anda ini, ya, dalam usaha mahu menonjolkan, ya, atau mengetengahkan keindahan agama yang kita panggil Islam ini, ya, terutama sekali kepada golongan bukan Muslim.
Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. I would say the only challenge really is just the number of hours in the day. There's so much to be done, and there are so many people to talk to, and you know, sometimes it saddens me that there just isn't enough time to tell people. The actual telling, it's not a challenge at all. I don't see it as a challenge, I see it as an opportunity. You know, it's a great opportunity that people allow you into their lives to talk to them about faith. I don't see things in terms of challenges. Because it's such a gift. I mean, it isn't even work. It's traveling, right? It's not a work at all. It's just a great joy. Imagine being invited by Darul Akam to visit Singapore. What a beautiful place. Well, you see, I could identify with non-Muslims. Before I accepted Islam, before I embraced Islam, I knew everything about Islam. You know, when I was a non-Muslim, I knew everything. I knew that Muslims blow themselves up and that they chop your hands off and that they hit women. I knew everything. No one needed to tell me anything about Islam. Well, of course, when I learned Islam, I learned it's not like that at all. But I know how people think. So the questions they ask are all questions. Even yesterday, I met a man here in Orchard Road. We were just talking in a shop. And he said to me, oh, yeah, but most people think that Muslims are bad people and terrorists. Well, I know that's what they think. I said, oh, well, that's not my experience, actually. My experience of Muslims is that they're very nice people. So I know how non-Muslims, many non-Muslims think. And it's just a matter of understanding their fears and not denying their fears. Sometimes we have a temptation to say, oh, no, but it's not like that. If that's what they think, that is their reality. So we have to address their reality rather than pretending, well, oh, no, it's not like that at all. So again, we need to stand in other people's shoes. It's a great gift. And see ourselves as other people see us. And if they think we're a threat, well, we have to behave to them as as we understand that they think we're a threat. And the way we do it is by showing them that we're not. Not just by talking. Talking won't work.
Encik Idris Tawfiq, terima kasih kerana sudi berbicara dengan kita untuk kali ini.
Brother, you honor me inviting me onto your program. May Allah bless you. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Amin, Ustaz.
Lupakan Nurul buat selama-lamanya. Ingat, engkau tu suami aku, Zahid.
Perasaan yang tersinggung.
Aku tak mampu melupakan.